And we also have the lesuria, in which only the state and the local government can legislate upon. That is, these are the basic tenets. Then each of these component units have the latitude to operate their own system of government. The federal government may operate the federal, I mean, they operate the presidential system of government. Then the states can operate the parliamentary system of government. For instance, in Kaduna State or in Zamfara, you can have Sharia state law there, where you don't drink beer. So you know that if you are going to that place, you don't go with your bottles of beer. That is clear. And they can change their own constitution at will. And finally, and most importantly, there's always the issue of fiscal federalism. You do not establish a state that cannot stand on its own financially, materially. So these are the issue of fiscal federalism. It's a simple norm for a true federalism, you know. Now, going to the issue of the national trust. I said it earlier that these are the crises and conflict that you have as a result of multi-ethnic relations and multi-religious interactions among the various societies and communities in a federalist framework. In Nigeria, there are certain manifestations of this national quest. The first one is power sharing. Who gets what, when, and how? Power is the possibility, the ability to share possibility of outcomes. And in politics, power is the most important thing. You know, you need power. Power sharing is a major issue in the Nigerian national quest. Now, this was not the case in the First Republic. As of in the First Republic, Ahmadu Bello had the opportunity of being the Prime Minister of Nigeria. He rejected it. He preferred to be the Premier of Northern Nigeria. Because as of that time, the regions were the unit of economic activities and decisions. And that was why the likes of Ibubafe Nawulowo was able to transform the Western region, introducing free education, free medical services, and the rest of that. I went to primary school free. Maybe why not for him? I would have been a Pawan Tapa in my village, Igedekiti. But because of this educational policy, and Nnamdi Azikiwe, Ahmadu Bello, and the rest of them, they did very well, you know? And today we are celebrating them. Now, why were they able to do this? They were able to do this because, as of that time, the regions were big enough for development to take place. So as of that time, it wasn't a major issue. Even as of 1967, when Nigeria had 12 states, it wasn't a major issue, because each of those component states could embark on endogenous development. They could do that very well. But things started changing when, as a sort of territorial incursion and military intervention in Nigerian politics, it started creating states that are not very federally dependent, that could not stand on their own. So as a result of this now, power sharing becomes a major issue in Nigeria. This is so because whosoever controls the federal apparatus controls Nigeria. That makes it a very serious national question. Now, the Igbos now are agitating that. They want their own to be present. Well, justifiably so, because they have not produced one. But that doesn't mean that if eventually an Igbo man becomes the president tomorrow, the Igbo people will benefit tremendously. Obasanjo was president of Nigeria for 8 years. I wouldn't know what I, as a Yoruba man, benefited on that. But that is the reality of today. People want their own to be the president. Power sharing has become a major problem. And you know what? This issue of power sharing is an intra-elite problem. The Nigerians don't care about who governs them. The moment you govern very well. But the sad reality is that the leadership, has not governed very well. And because of this, people are asking for sovereign national conference. I don't know whether that will solve the problem. But if we look at the figures, what we have today, of the 12 leaders that have ruled Nigeria, 12, only 4 have come from the south, the rest from the north, 17.5 years. Out of the 57 years of independence, the south, that's counting Obasanjo twice anyway. Then of these 57 years, the south has ruled for only 17 and a half years. So they are asking for more. Just like what I said, this is not the issue here. The issue is good governance. If you can get that, Nigerians don't care so much about who governs them. But the reality of today is that bad leadership, corruption, craft stealing are the realities of today. And the impact of this is that Nigeria is suffering from serious debilitating immobilism. And centrifugal and centripetal forces are taking over. Sadly. Now, the second manifestation of this, of the national policy, is revenue allocation and resource control. You know, the ideas are very funny. Shortly when Obasanjo became president, the northern elite, they came together, they said, well, they have shortchanged, they want to introduce Sharia code. You know the response of their southern counterparts? He said, well, take your Sharia, but mind you, in Sharia state, you don't drink alcohol, you don't drink beer. So when we are distributing VAT on alcohol, you are not going to have to share out of it. You know? And they also said that, take your Sharia. You know, these people can be very funny. They are pranksters. The ordinary person in the street doesn't bother himself about all of this. But that is the argument. Take your Sharia, we take our resources. Now, it has always been an intra-elite problem. Then, another problem here is that of ethno-religious conflict. You have them a lot everywhere. You know, Hausa versus Yoruba, Yoruba versus other ethnic groups, and so on. There are so many of them, especially since the commencement of the Fourth Republic. In those areas where minorities were ruling, especially in Jos North and other places, as a result of liberalization and democracy, now popular rule became the order of the day. So as a result of all these contradictions, there were problems and crises. But let me say this. Most of the problems that we term ethno-religious conflicts, basically they are not. They have economic undertones. You look at the issue of this Boko Haram insurgency in the north, northeast. There are so many elements of economic economic elements there. Unemployment, poverty, ignorance, and disease. Like Julius Mwalimu Nyerere said, that Africa suffers from the unholy trinity of poverty, ignorance, and disease. All these manifestations are here in Nigeria. So if you hear of maybe the Hausas and the Igbos fighting, or whatever, it has an economic impact. So, ethno-religious crisis is a major problem because the ethnic nationalities mistrust themselves. They don't trust each other. And that is why what I will say, that Nigeria is a mere geographical expression. See, it's still at stake. A typical Hausa man does not trust an Igbo man. An Igbo man does not trust a Yoruba man. How then do we develop a nation in that respect? You know, these are the problems. That is why we have ethnic crisis, ethno-religious crisis in Nigeria. Then another manifestation of the national person problem in Nigeria is the issue of national insecurity. Well, you have all of them there, you know, the Boko Haram insurgency, the Hasmen killings, the Hasmen versus the farmers crisis. In this year alone, over 2,000 have been killed. This is very sad. And if, like I said, the Fulani man that you see, when we are growing up, we are very peaceful, loving people. And they have, what they have is the cattle, which they have to rear. It's an economic issue. And some people, when I hear people saying that, well, the federal government must not help a billion ranches for these people. It's not, for me, it's reductionist. You know why? The Americans, the Axis powers, the Allied powers, defeated the Axis powers in 1945. The Americans went to Europe under the Marshall Plan with billions of dollars. Today, Germany has been defeated in that war, in the strongest economy in Europe. We can't close our eyes to all of these things. We need to have a broad mind. We need to help these Fulani Caturias to build their ranches in order to have peace. But if we keep on arguing this way, that, well, it's a private enterprise, for me, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't show that we are nationalistic and we are patriotic. I've argued that severally in my works. You know, that's my position. And that the issue of this corporate existence of Nigeria, I've said all of this in all actually on my publication. That's what I've been searching into. And we need to be broad-minded, we need to be patriotic. So, do you know what? When you are talking of national economic crisis, when you are talking of insecurity in Nigeria today, the Boko Haram insurgency is not one. It's not a serious one. Neither is it hyper or the rest of them. The biggest threat to Nigeria's security today is poverty. It's ignorance. It's illiteracy. It's disease. When I was coming today, when I was driving to this place, I saw some young boys with their blue plastic bowls begging for food in the streets. Those boys, for God's sake, must be taking off the streets. Until you do this, there will always be crisis everywhere. And most of the crisis we have in Nigeria today, they are in the north. And this is because of ignorance. The northern elite, I'm very sorry to say this, I hope I'm not stepping on toes. You know, but that's the reality today. Well, I hope I'm safe. No, my point here is yes, sir. So these people must be taking all the keys in the north. Most of the crisis we have today, they're in the northern part of Nigeria. And this is so because the elite are using them. The Ashurian will be in Harvard, will be in Yale, will be in Oxford. They give these boys 1,000 naira with petrol and matches, go and be burning people's houses. That is an oxymoron. It doesn't make sense to anybody. But that is the reality, the sad reality today, which must change. Finally, as far as the national question is concerned, we have a growing economic crisis. 70% of the Nigerian population lives below the poverty line. That is, they spend less than $2 in the day. Poverty is an enemy of democracy. It's an enemy of democracy. Democracy cannot thrive in a situation of absolute poverty that we have in Nigeria today. And the federal government, the state governments, and the local governments must be. And solving this problem in such a way that Nigeria will be the better place and there is development in the nation. Now, these are the basic national question crises we have in Nigeria. Now, let's talk about the crisis of development. Well, development is a multidimensional approach to a positive change which moves the people closer to meeting their basic needs in terms of housing, education, health, and the rest of that. That's how Julius Nyerere defines the development. Then, Dorothy Sayers, a British economist, asked this question. You want to know whether a nation is developed. You ask what is happening to poverty, unemployment, and inequality. He says, here you have all of these, or any of them, by no standard, such a country is not developed. And all of these are in Nigeria, perfectly available. So you can say Nigeria is developing. Nigeria is not developing at all. Independence in 1957. There are two basic economic paradigms. The neoliberal economic doctrine. I mean, the Keynesian economic doctrine and the neoliberal economic doctrine. Well, neoliberal economic doctrine says that there are going to be massive involvement of government in the running of the economy. We did that for a while. We started establishing private enterprise, public enterprises, NEPA, ITEL, and the rest of them.
and I know that these are citadels of corruption. And at the point, the government has to sell them because they are quantified for stealing, inefficiency, and bureaucracy. So, Keynesianism did not work. It worked in Europe when Edmund Keynes published his book titled General Theory of Employment, Interest, and Money in 1936. They employed his prescription, and the depression and the economic crisis in Europe stopped. But after a while, in the late 1960s, I argued this in my book, The Nigerian Political Economy, Chapter 2 of that. I argued this copiously in that chapter. You know, Milton Friedman of the Chicago School and his lieutenants, he said, well, Keynesianism is an enemy of development. And that what if for any nation to develop, there's a need for less government. The government will answer so that there could be development. And coupled with the emergence of ultra-conservative leaders, like Ronald Reagan of the United States, Brian Mulroney of Canada, Edmund Paul of Germany, and the rest of them, Margaret Thatcher of Britain, all of them came together, and they made neoliberalism, which is synonymous with the structural adjustment program, a condition, the conditionalities for taking the IMF or World Bank loans. You know? And Nigeria adopted this system in 1986. Under the Obama regime, you and I know the consequences. This paradigm extended the frontiers of poverty in Nigeria. Nigerians became massively poor. You see, this system, this neoliberal doctrine, is imperialist. And many of their prescriptions are oxymoronic. What do I mean? They say, for instance, you remove subsidies on essential commodities. You want to produce more commodities, more agricultural products. You are imposing, you are removing subsidies on fertilizer. And you want to increase productivity in agriculture. It is a serious contradiction. Again, let me say this. They talk about trade liberalization. You open up the economy of your economy to the world. You start importing foreign fabrics. If all of us in this hall, the president, the governors, start wearing local fabrics, the Alabi textile mill will spring back to life, and the rest of them. But that is what neoliberalism is telling you, the Washington consensus. It will never work. And that is, we have seen that it's not working in Nigeria. Now, these are the contradictions. Where here, we adopted this young economic doctrine, it did not work. Neoliberalism did not work. And it's not even working now, still. Now, the question now is, what is the way out? Do I claim to know the answer to this? Become an answer? No. But I know two things. The first one here is that we must look inwards. Look, Nigeria is hugely blessed in terms of human resources. There are so many economists, brilliant economists, industrialists that could come together and fashion out a homegrown paradigm for Nigeria to develop. That's number one, I know that. Number two, I know that for Nigeria to develop, we can't be a monocultural economy depending only on one resource. Now, the price of oil today is $80. Everybody is celebrating. Tomorrow, it will drop to 20. That is political, economic instability. So we must diversify the revenue base of the Nigerian economy. Now, let's go back to what we have today, the current realities in the Nigerian federalism, the contradictions in the Nigerian federalist framework. One, we have a federal government that has turned into a leviathan. Too strong, too powerful. The federal government takes 53-something% of revenue allocation. That is too much. That's number one. Number two, you have 36 states that are federally dependent and they cannot develop on their own. Whatever development does Ekiti, Osun, Jigawa, another state, whatever development can they have? They are too small.
all these things, there has to be a way of looking at it. I want to suggest, I don't know whether that will work. Now you go back to the 12-state structure, but I know, thank God, no governor is here. Because we are saying this to attend that they are going to lose their jobs. You know. But I believe that so strongly that the 36-state structure we have today is debilitating, is affecting our march to progress negatively, and must be done away with at all costs. Then, number three now, the sub-regional units, or the units we have, the states, the local governments, they are incapable of embarking on endogenous development. They are not. They can't do that because they are too small. So, I believe for Nigeria federalism to work very well, there must be a lot of decentralization of power to the regions. The powers of the federal government must be reduced substantially. And there must also be patriotic duty, patriotism on behalf of each and every one of us here. Nigeria cannot develop until we have that responsibility, that sense of patriotism. Love Nigeria. What are you doing with your interest? Your monthly allocation? Well, yours is even so small. Those of them may be sending their earning 13.5 million. We don't know what they are doing with that. But the little one you are earning in your own small corner there, use it very well for this nation. Now, become my answer, the chairman and the special guest of honor. What is my academic position on all of this over the years? One, I'm fundamentally opposed to the dismemberment of Nigeria. So like I said earlier, it doesn't make sense for anybody to start thinking of breaking up Nigeria today. You know, when I hear of IPOB, I laugh. Because I know that they are not sincere. The goals in Kaduna State can feed the economy of Kaduna State today. They are into spare parts, electronics, hospitality industry. You say you want to go away. Go away and let's see. And mind you, you want to go away. I hope I'm not in trouble with some people here. Especially the academic folks. So, I say you want to go away. Go away. But remember that the South South people will not go with you. You have a small landmass. Where will you go? The Yoruba people. Where will you go deploy your professors? In my village. No. I'm one of the youngest professors in my village. Where will you deploy all this manpower to? The Hausa people, they are ever before me. I'm sure they are not serious. Is it Guinea-Corn you used to tar the road from Kano to Abuja? We need each other. Nigeria must remain a strong, barren United Nations. United country, where peace, justice shall reign. That's my first submission. Number two, there's a need to restructure Nigeria. The worst enemies of Nigeria are those people that are craving for the sustenance of this 36-state structure. The thing will never work. It has never worked. And you know what? The biggest tragedy to the Nigerian federalist framework is military rule. Well, I'm sorry to say this is a military establishment, but then that's the truth. Of all the creations of the states created in Nigeria, only one was created by the civilians. The rest of them are created by military rule, by Tunisia and Russia. It's a serious problem. You know what? In this very hall, when I was an assistant lecturer, I said, in this hall, it was a battle hall then. When there was an event, I said, I pray to God that I will live long. And two, that in my long life I will never see this room again. The deputy commander then was looking at me too long. I said, you know what? Well, this room is still your home, and it is still your home. You can criticize the army now, but criticizing for my things, I will not be arrested. I don't know why I'm not being arrested anyway. But they are not being arrested people. Let me tell you what happened in 1996.
Sorry for that.
Well, I went to give a lecture in the Young Forces Command at Staff College, the senior division. Then, after my presentation, one major got up. I was 26. He said, "Sir, what is your personal opinion about the transition program of General Sani Abacha?" My personal opinion? Well, I paused for a while. I remember my young wife and my two little children. And I told myself that if I answer this question, will I get to Kaduna safely? I said, no, I won't answer this question. That is why you are seeing me standing before you. But you know what? 4 years later, 2000, I went to deliver the same lecture in that same hall, Danjuma Hall. I blasted Obasanjo regime. I blasted the president himself. I drove safely back to Kaduna. That is the beauty of democracy. Don't let us forget where we are coming from. This democracy must be sustained. That's part of my submission. And I believe that I've fought for long. Well, I believe that if we take note of all of this, I believe that Nigeria will be a stronger, more developed nation. We move from its limbo, economic limbo, and we cease to be a country of the future and a fully developed country. Now, what am I doing currently? When I became a professor 8 years ago, since then I published two books. Kamini Fege and I published a 412-page book titled Nigerian Government and Politics. It's there, you can check, it's in our regular bookshop. Then I published a novel, a 249-page novel. You know why I published it as a novel? I know Nigerians don't like reading books, textbooks especially. When you see Introduction to International Relations, they will not even touch it. So I said, let me look at the Nigerian government and politics through a literary perspective. That is what I did in that book. Don't think it's about kissing and all of that in the book. There are other things. You see, they are not meant for the June 12th election in that book. So I copied that book. Then I have a page titled International Relations and Political Science Scholar. You know, gentlemen, the dynamics of community service has changed. Each time I go to Amphosis Command and Staff College and other places to deliver lecture, I always see about 200 people. But now, under my page, there are articles I write that 3,000 people will read. Well, I publish over 250 articles on that page. Next year, by the grace of God, I'm going to publish that. Please, the DMC, sir, tell the commandant this, that wherever he is, I will send a copy of that book to you and you too, and the deputy commandant. So hopefully by next year that book will be out. That's what I'm doing currently. Then what are my future academic projections? Well, I still have about 10 years to stay here. What things being equal, banning nuclear holocaust. I intend to do this. This my page will continue, which means on the average, every 4 years I'll be publishing a book. That is 2 weeks. Then I want to chronicle my experiences in the Nigerian Defense Academy, which I call Nigeria's Defense Policy and Academic Perspective. I want to look at the Nigerian foreign policy of all those governments during which I have served as in any way. That is the Abacha address of them. Then I want to tell my experiences here. That's what I call my own memo. You know? As an academic in the Nigerian Defense Academy, the good, the bad, and the ugly. If you think the academy is the worst place to work, go to the State University and see what is happening there. And you know what? There was one time, in 2010, I had an accident on my way home between Lokoja and Okene. I saw this jeep just move past me, slowly. Turn back. Then the colonel came down. He said, "Ah, this Professor Alabi." He said, "Yes, how are you?" I said, "Who are you?" I said, "You taught me commander and staff college." He said, "What happened, sir?" I said, "As you see, my car had a problem and I can't travel." You know what he did? He called his friend working in the road safety office in Lokoja he told my level. He took me to okay, put me inside the bed that took me to Ekiti without paying a call. That was one of my happiest days here. I want to chronicle all these experiences in my book that I want to write ultimately. And well, there's still one lecture to be delivered here. That is the valedictory lecture. I will state all of this, what I've done between now and that time. Well, the special guest of honor, the commandant, the academy folks, I want to thank you most sincerely for your attention. And in the course of my stay here, I owe some people a debt of gratitude. Let me start with members of the special guest of honor. You know, when I was leaving my office yesterday, day before yesterday, the dean's office, I look at the chronicle of appointments as dean of the insider. I saw my name in 2008 as the only associate professor. Maybe General Ekoko, I mean Professor Ekoko. I became dean through election. It was through his policy that I became dean. I never expected it. And he supported me throughout my 2.5 years tenure as dean. The special guest of honor, sir. Thank you so much. And you even promoted me as associate professor. You know, I can never forget you. Thank you so much. I want to thank the commandant for being the deputy commandant, the trust, and especially the academic provost. You have been my academic mentor, guardian over these years. Thank you, sir. You have been most wonderful. Especially in the delivery of this lecture, you gave me some pieces of advice that actually work. I want to thank my faculty members. They have been most wonderful. Yes, they have. I want to primarily and most sincerely thank members of staff of Coach Kusai. They are very great people. They are the greatest people in this academy. You have been wonderful. You have given me the support for 27 years. I thank you so much. God bless you. I want to also thank General Tewe for being here, taking his time to be here. Thank you so much. Even though he's my PhD student, don't think because you are here, you will pass very easily. You have to work very hard. Thank you for coming, sir. I appreciate that. Well, I want to thank my family, my dear wife, Shadi. They have been there for me for close to 30 years. They are not to be here today, but for some other important reason. I want to thank my four sons, Nka, Sheyi, Ayo, and Ayode. They have been most wonderful children. And I pray that one day, one of them in particular, when he's delivering his inaugural lecture, I will be there. Like to return to this. But finally, I give all the thanks to my Savior Jesus Christ, who loved me so much and gave his life for me on the cross of Calvary. At the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. Thank you so much for your attention.
And privileged experience. Professor, thank you very much. May we be seated, please. In recognition, and I will also humbly invite the Commandant, Nigerian Defense Academy, and the Academy Provost for the decoration of the guest lecturer as an inaugurated professor of Nigerian Defense Academy. The guest lecturer is going to be decorated with a medallion and a sash, just as we can see the other inaugurated lecturers appear. May I invite the Academy Provost in company of the Commandant Nigerian Defense Academy to decorate the guest lecturer. Congratulations, sir. Congratulations, sir. This is a dream of every academic. At the same time, the guest lecturer is being presented by... Thank you very much, sir. May I also humbly invite the special guest of honor to present the guest lecturer with a plaque in recognition of his inauguration as a professor of political science. Thank you very much, sir. Congratulations, sir. We appreciate your sharing of your wealth of knowledge with us. Thank you, sir. The way is the lack of development in Nigeria that is generating the national crisis, which has resulted to the current clamor for political restructuring. And if only Nigeria was that is in government, we are pleading that you pass the message out for us. We have a professor in Nigerian Defense Academy who has a clear knowledge of the solution to the national crisis. Please spread the knowledge and let the world hear. Thank you very much, Professor. At this point, we won't listen to the comments by the representative of guest lecturer's mentee, the impact of the professor on his mentee. May I call on an MPN?
Director of Military Training, Brigadier General MKG. Our special guest of honor today, retired General Yerima. And the amiable professor that we are gathered here today for his inaugural lecture. Our senior lecturers here, senior officers, other students of postgraduate school, gentlemen cadets of Nigerian Defense Academy. It's actually an honor and privilege for me to stand here on behalf of the mentees of Professor Joe Alabi. As you can see from the lecture presented, Professor Alabi has shown how incisive, meticulous, and very detailed he is about the Nigerian question.